Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the QUT Faculty of Law for today's conference on intellectual property and education in the age of COVID. As is always the case, we'd like to acknowledge the traditional owners, and in keeping with the spirit of reconciliation, we acknowledge the traditional owners of the lands where QUT now stands and recognise that these have always been places of teaching and learning. And we wish to pay respect to their elders, past, present and emerging, and acknowledge the important role Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people continue to play within the QUT community. And in the context of debates around intellectual property and education, there has been very significant discussion about the importance of Indigenous intellectual property. Today's event is going to look at some of the relationships and connections and intersections between intellectual property and education. It will cover many different species of intellectual property, spanning copyright law, trademark law, patent law, trade secrets, and questions of licensing. In many ways, the conference today is also going to span an array of different disciplines within education, everything from the creative industries to medicine and biotechnology and even clean technology. In addition, this event is also going to focus upon open licensing within the educational institutions. So the use of open licensing to promote open access, open innovation and open data is also a very kind of important dimension in terms of the debate and discussion over intellectual property and education. This event is also going to focus upon the role of universities and educational institutions and research organisations in responding to the coronavirus COVID-19 public health crisis. So universities and research institutions have a very particular special role to play as keystones in the knowledge infrastructure. They are generating a whole wide range of technologies that could be of use in tackling the coronavirus crisis, including vaccines, treatments and diagnostics, as well as a range of other public policy solutions. So this event, amongst other things, is going to think about ways and means in which we can encourage public transfer of some of those research and public policy solutions. Finally, this event is also going to be an Australian launch for this research handbook on intellectual property and technology transfer, edited by Professor Jacob Rooksbury from Gonzaga Law School. This collection provides a comparative analysis of how an array of different countries manage intellectual property and technology transfer from educational institutions, and also kind of includes a contribution by myself looking at intellectual property and higher education and 3D printing. So welcome everyone. I hope you enjoy today's range of presentations looking at different aspects of intellectual property and education. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, my presentation today is going to be on the Internet Archive, the National Emergency Library, copyright law and the coronavirus. This presentation in particular looks at some of the issues in relation to the operation of copyright flexibilities in the context of a public health emergency. And this work partly evolves out of a very kind of long-standing interest in relation to issues around copyright law and culture. So my PhD, which I did at the end of the 1990s, was focused on copyright law and cultural studies. But one of my kind of early books, Digital Copyright and the Consumer Revolution, was in particular kind of concerned about copyright law and the emergence of new search engines like Google. And I think many of those key issues come up again in this new context. To begin with, during the coronavirus COVID-19 pandemic, many libraries, schools, and educational institutions have been shuttered during the lockdown. And as a result, students, teachers and communities have been bereft over access to books. So the coronavirus lockdown has kind of interfered with our normal networks that are in operation in relation to knowledge. The Internet Archive, led by digital librarian Bruce DeKale, has sought to alleviate that problem through the Internet Archive making a wider range of books available under the National Emergency Library. A bit of context and a bit of history to begin with. Bruce DeKale has been very much concerned about reinventing the library for the digital age, and he has said, as a digital librarian, you should serve and protect each patron as if she were your only employer. The Internet Archive is a non-profit digital library offering free universal access to books, movies and music, as well as archive web pages. It's based in San Francisco. I kind of visited the Internet Archive back in 2014. So it's set up in a grand old church in San Francisco. The Internet Archive, because of its activities, has had some previous experience with copyright law. There was at one stage a series of constitutional challenges against the copyright term extension that took place in the United States under the Sonny Bono Copyright Term Extension Act. Bruce DeKale launched unsuccessfully one of those actions in the Kale versus Gonzalez action. And they're kind of particularly concerned about the public domain being deprived of new works falling into public access. The Internet Archive celebrated the reopening of the public domain with the expiry of the copyright works whose life had been extended by the Sonny Bono Copyright Term Extension Act. The Internet Archive has also had a lot of experience of dealing with copyright takedown requests of one kind or another, particularly under the Digital Millennium Copyright Act of 1998. But also they've sometimes had issues in terms of their caching of works as well. This present dispute really centres around the Internet Archive digitising books, stealing copyright protection, and then making those available for lending and borrowing as part of the National Emergency Library. So the National Emergency Library was really established to provide a temporary collection of books that supports emergency remote teaching, research activities, independent scholarship, and intellectual stimulation while universities, schools, training centres and libraries are closed. Bruce DeKale kind of imagined that this was our dream for the original internet coming to life, the library at everyone's fingertips. A range of libraries, universities and communities supported this initiative. Chris Berg, who's the director of MIT Libraries, commented, "In a global pandemic, robust digital lending options are key to a library's ability to care for staff and the community by allowing all of us to work remotely and maintain the recommended social distancing." Historian Jill Lepore also praised the National Emergency Library, observing, "If the books you need aren't in any bookstore, and especially if you are one of the currently more than 1 billion students and teachers shut out of your classroom, please sign up, log on and borrow." The Internet Archive acknowledged that the National Emergency Library would not be a complete or total solution to educational needs during the pandemic. They also recognised that authors and publishers were going to be impacted by the global pandemic as well, and it encouraged its users to also buy books from their local bookstores. But the Internet Archive was of the view that it was hopeful that publishers and authors would cooperate with the initiative. And they also kind of were of the view that would only ever be a temporary initiative. A number of users of the National Emergency Library have provided testimonials. So sometimes the National Emergency Library has been used for health and medical research, particularly during the coronavirus. It's been used for all sorts of teaching and study and scholarly purposes, and has also been used to alleviate boredom. For their part, the publishers were deeply upset about the National Emergency Library. Maria Palenti, the president of the Association of American Publishers and the former head of the US Copyright Office, said, "We are stunned by the Internet Archive's aggressive, unlawful, and opportunistic attack on the rights of authors and publishers in the midst of novel coronavirus pandemic." And several large commercial publishing houses, including the Hatchet Book Group, HarperCollins Publishers, John Wiley and Sons, and Penguin Random House, brought an action under copyright law against the Internet Archive in respect of its Open Archive and the National Emergency Library in the District Court of the Southern District of New York. In some respects, I was kind of surprised that this action took place, when it did and how it did. You know, given that the United States is still firmly in the grip of the coronavirus pandemic and that there had been, you know, large-scale protests for Black Lives Matter, I was a little bit surprised that the publishers took this copyright action when they did. But you know, and with the tone that they did as well. So the lawsuit uses very kind of high rhetoric about what it accuses the Internet Archive of. It kind of invokes the language of piracy. It says, "Despite the Open Library moniker, Internet Archive's actions grossly exceed legitimate library services to violence to the Copyright Act and constitute willful digital piracy on an industrial scale. Consistent with the deplorable nature of piracy, the Internet Archive's infringement is intentional and systematic. It produces mirror image copies of millions of unaltered in copyright works for which it has no rights and distributes them in their entirety for reading purposes to the public for free, including voluminous numbers of books that are currently commercially available." So in terms of the cause of actions, the first cause of action is for direct copyright infringement. The second cause of action is for secondary copyright infringement under the theories of contributory liability, inducement liability, applying the Supreme Court of the United States precedent in relation to the Grokster case, and vicarious liability. In terms of its prayer for relief, the publishers seek a declaration that the practices of the Internet Archive constitute willful copyright infringement. They seek an injunction. They seek statutory damages from the Internet Archive. Alternatively, they have asked for an account of profits, as well as attorney's fees and interest. In terms of the works at stake in this lawsuit, really there's a cross-section of literary works. Some Nobel Prize-winning works, including William Golding's Lord of the Flies, Toni Morrison's Song of Solomon, Cormac McCarthy's The Road, are caught up in the lawsuit. J.D. Salinger's The Catcher in the Rye is one of the books at issue. But there's also James Corey's science fiction series, The Expanse, a book by Terry Pratchett, the Narnia works, some of the works of the children's author Lemony Snicket. There's also non-fiction works such as Bill Bryson's A Short History of Nearly Everything, Malcolm Gladwell's works, Steve Silverman's Neurotribes, and the For Dummies series. The Authors Guild has supported the publisher's lawsuit. Doug Preston, author and president of the Authors Guild, said the Internet Archive's wholesale scanning and posting of copyrighted books without the consent of authors is piracy, hidden behind a sanctimonious veil of progressivism. Likewise, Mary Ratzenberger, the Author Guild Executive Director, tries to frame the dispute in terms of authors' rights, maintaining that the Internet Archive has demonstrated a blatant disregard for authors' rights and a lack of respect or acknowledgement that creators deserve to be compensated for their creative work. The dispute no doubt raises a new context with which to think about the nature and scope of the defence of fair use under United States copyright law. United States copyright law has evolved very significantly. In the 1980s, there was a strong emphasis upon the level of commercial use in terms of considerations about the defence of fair use, and that kind of reached its high point in the dispute involving Salinger and Ian Hamilton over a biography of Salinger. Then in the early 1990s, in the Pretty Woman case, the Supreme Court of the United States emphasized that the purpose of the defense of fair use is to promote transformative uses of copyright work. And that precedent has been a very significant and important one. Most notably, it has been applied in the long-running litigation between publishers and authors and the search engine Google over the Google Books project, involving digitizing books and making them available in snippet form online. In the kind of the key dispute in 2016 of the Authors Guild versus Google, Justice LaValle emphasized that Google's unauthorized digitizing of the copyright protected works, creation of the search functionality and display of snippets from those works, and non-infringing uses. The purpose of the copying is highly transformative. The public display of text is limited, and the revelations do not provide a significant market substitute for the protected aspects of the original. So that is a really significant precedent. In that dispute, the Authors Guild also kind of passionately kind of complained about that digitization project, but the US court system in the end held that Google Books was protected by the defense of fair use. Moreover, the Authors Guild had another important defeat in a dispute against the Hathaway Trust. In this case, the Court of Appeals of the Second Circuit upheld Hathaway Trust's right to maintain a database to search for books, stating that the creation of full text searchable database is a quintessentially transformative use. So in the context of this dispute, there's a lot of debate about whether the National Emergency Library will be protected by the Defence of Fair Use. The Electronic Frontier Foundation, also based in San Francisco, is helping defend the Internet Archive. A range of library copyright specialists and scholars have also supported the claims of the Internet Archive. The library copyright specialists have noted that the US is in a time of crisis. They have noted that US copyright law is well equipped to provide the flexibility necessary for the vast majority of remote learning needed at this time. And in particular, the fair use doctrine accommodates the flexibility required by our shared public health crisis, enabling society to function and progress while protecting human life and safety. Corinne McSherry of the Electronic Frontier Foundation has also kind of noted that during the coronavirus lockdown, for many of us, the internet is not only our town square, but also our school, art gallery, museum, and library. So this dispute will provide a really interesting test case in terms of the nature and scope of the defence of fair use. It also raises questions around the operation of library exceptions in relation to copyright law and the use of digital lending as a practice. In their lawsuit, the publishers deny that the Internet Archive can rely upon lending privileges, saying that they have invented and concocted a theory called controlled digital lending. Brewster Kahle, for his part, says controlled digital lending is how many libraries have been providing access to digitized books for 9 years. It is a legal framework where one reader at a time can read a digitized copy of a legally owned library book. The Association of Research Libraries and Spark have emphasized that controlled digital library lending is particularly important during the COVID pandemic to ensure academic and research continuity. And Kyle Courtney of Harvard University has also emphasized that, you know, libraries and archives have superpowers under copyright law that allow them to supply their communities with access to materials for research, scholarship, and study. The dispute over the Internet Archive also raises some large questions in terms of intermediary liability and safe harbors. The Internet Archive said that they would take down works expeditiously if they were kind of contacted by authors or publishers. The US Copyright Office has been reviewing the Digital Millennium Copyright Act of 1998, and really the dispute of the Internet Archive has been part of that larger debate about whether that regime is still fit for purpose and well adapted. The US Congressman Tom Tillis has been aligning himself with the authors and publishers and has been questioning the approach taken by the Internet Archive. In response to this litigation, the National Emergency Library is being shut down early. Brewster Kahle is kind of concerned about the lawsuit affecting the future operation of the library, so he's kind of closed it down entirely. Recently, in a Zoom discussion, he's kind of called for a settlement of the dispute in the boardroom rather than in the courtroom. And he is concerned and distressed that the publishers are continuing to push on with the litigation. And in the wider scholarly community, there has been a lot of concern about the future fate of the Internet Archive. There are many essential resources like the Wayback Machine that would be affected if the Internet Archive was forced to close down. From my perspective as an intellectual property scholar, I think the dispute raises some larger interesting questions about emergency powers under intellectual property law and policy. In the field of patent law and access to medicines, we've long recognised that governments have the ability to use powers such as compulsory licences and crown use to provide access to patent inventions in relation to health crises. Indeed, the UN Secretary General's high-level panel report stressed that nation states should avail themselves of such flexibilities within the patent regime. Ruth Dreyfus, who was the former leader of Switzerland, led that report. And that has long been recognised, that in circumstances of a public health emergency, nation states can use patent exceptions and flexibilities to respond to such a health crisis. I think the interesting thing about the COVID crisis is that not only do you have some of those issues around patent law and access to essential medicines, but you also have issues in relation to copyright law and access to knowledge. You know, UNESCO has recognised that there has been a huge amount of interruption to classroom learning during the global public health pandemic. And that has been a really significant and serious problem. And organisations like IFLA, the International Federation of Library Associations, has argued that this is an opportunity to think about ways and means of utilising some of the existing copyright exceptions to respond to the public health emergency. But they've also kind of flagged that maybe this is an opportune moment to rethink copyright law, to try to enumerate some of the emergency powers that should operate in times of emergency. And, you know, perhaps there should be some sort of lasting change in relation to copyright law in a post-COVID world. So in conclusion, it's a really fascinating copyright dispute between publishers and the Internet Archive over copyright law, fair use, library lending, and intermediary liability. The dispute raises larger questions about copyright flexibilities and defences and how they can be used in times of emergency. And moreover, there's a kind of a larger question there in terms of access to knowledge. And there's a lot of concern that the Internet Archive might be affected in the future. Hopefully, cooler heads will prevail and there will be some sort of reconciliation between authors and publishers and libraries and the Internet Archive, and that this dispute will be resolved peacefully. Otherwise, we may need to look at copyright law reform to ensure that we can promote education, learning, and access to knowledge as primary objectives of our copyright regime. Thank you very much.